Hello dear students, welcome back to the class. As we have completed the chapter that is units and measurement, you have learned so much about dimension analysis, the significant figures, the errors, the accuracy and so many things. So let us just check whether we are now able to do the question for the based for the pattern which is based on the CBSE. Are we able to do that or not? So let us just start with the CBSE pattern question exercise. So let us begin with the first question of the chapter. Here in the question we say that if the error in the measurement of radius of a sphere is 2%, the error in the radius of a sphere is 2%, then what is the error in the determination of volume of the sphere? Now here sphere has been given, the volume has been given, the radius has been given. So definitely we are going to use one formula, that is nothing but V equals to 4 by 3 pi r cube. This is nothing but the volume of sphere. Now since we know that we have formula V equals to 4 by 3 pi r cube, which is giving a relation between the volume and the radius. So let us just see. What are they asking? Error in the radius of the sphere has been given as 2%. Now you know that we have covered the topic how to find out the error. So simply, if we are going to find out the error, we are going to write this as delta V by V. 4 by 3 pi is constant, so we are going to ignore this term, and this r is having the power of 3. So this 3 will be coming here. And we will be having delta r by r into 100%. This is the percentage error which has been given over here. This is 2% has been given. So now what we are going to do? We have been given this value of delta r by r. In the question, the value that has been given to us into 100% equals to 2%. This has been given to us. So what we are going to do, we are going to put the value over here. We will be having 6% as the volume error, delta V by V, or you can write it as delta V by V into 100 equals to 6%, and that is what we are having the error in the determination of volume of the sphere. So the answer is 6%. Okay. So this was the way to handle such question. Now we will be moving towards the next question, that is the question number 2. Okay, so here the question arises from the unit dimension. Here the velocity v of a particle at time t is given by V equals to at plus b upon t plus c. This equation has been given, where a, b and c are constants, and we have to find the dimension of a, b and c. Have I told you how to find out the dimension of such things, of such equation? Yeah, I remember I telling you, I mean, how to find out the dimension of the equations, of the formulas and so many things. So that is the way how we are going to start the question and going to proceed further for it. Here in this question we have been given V equals to at plus b upon t plus c, and we have to find out the dimension for a, b and c. So how we are going to do this? Just look at this. I have told you one principle, that was principle of homogeneity, and this principle says that whatever the values has been written over here in the left hand side and the right hand side of the equation, they are going to have the same dimension. That means the power of the dimension should be same on both the sides of equation. So we are using this principle, in that according to that principle we can say that V equals to at. V equals to at, that means I am talking about the dimension of V equals to at. So dimension of V is velocity. So dimension of velocity is what? We have learnt about that. It is Lt minus 1 equals to A into T. A is written as such, Now T is time. So what could be the expected dimension of A from here? LT minus 1 divided by T. So finally, we will be having the dimension of A as LT minus 2. This is the dimension of A. What we have found? We have found the dimension of A as LT minus 2. Now B and C are left. Now accordingly, similarly with the same principle, we can say T and C, they should be having the same dimension because they are being added up. And when the two things are being added, that means their dimensions are going to be same. So we can say C, the dimension of C equals to the dimension of T. How we are going to write the dimension of T? This T is nothing but the time. So we can say this is nothing but capital T, because we denote the dimension of time as the capital T with the square brackets. So the dimension of C has been found out as the capital T. So I can write over here, this is capital T. Now one thing that has been left here is B. So let us just proceed and find out the dimension of B. Now here in this equation, we can see that again this complete B upon T plus C should be equals to V, because principle of homogeneity. So let us just start. We can write that B upon T plus C equals to V. Now again, we know that the dimension of T and C is equal. So we can say, and B is what? B we have to find. So we can write it as V into T plus C. This should be the dimension of V. This should be the dimension of T plus C. So we know that the dimension of V, that means velocity, is LT minus 1. Now multiply it with T plus C. Now as I told you, this C and T are equal, they are having same dimension. So you can write it as 2 times T, 2 times of capital T. But we ignore the numerical values over here when we are dealing with the dimensions. So we can simply write this as capital T. So we are now having T minus 1 plus 1, they will be cancelled. So we are having the power of T as 0. So finally, we can write the dimension of B as this, L. So finally, dimension of A, LT minus 2, dimension of B, L, dimension of C is T. This was the question. Now we will be moving towards the next question. The question number C says that in a vernier caliper. Now, by reading only the mere vernier caliper, I can understand the question could be related to the least count. So, yeah, I can see the least count as well. This is the least count. First of all, read out the question. In a vernier calipers, n divisions of vernier scale coincide with the n minus 1 scale, n minus 1 divisions of the main scale, in which length of one division is 1 mm. So find out the least count of the instrument. I remember I told you how to find out the least count of vernier caliper as well as screw gauge. So the question is related to vernier caliper, and the situation has been given over here that n divisions of vernier scale coincide, that means we are going to write an equation form, with the n minus 1 division of main scale. Okay, so we can simply write this again in the form n vernier scale division equals to n minus 1 main scale division. So if I talk about the 1 vernier scale division, I can simply write it as n minus 1 upon n main scale division. Now, because they are saying to find out the least count of the instrument, we know least count of the vernier caliper is nothing but 1 MSD, that means 1 main scale division minus 1 VSD, that means vernier scale division. So, we are having the value of 1 vernier scale division with us, that is n minus 1 upon n. So, we are going to put the value n minus 1 upon n main scale division. So, let us just solve for this. This n minus n plus 1 divided by n. So, we will be left with nothing but, let me just write over here, we will be left with 1 upon n multiplied 1 main scale division. Now, here we know that in the question we have been given that 1 main scale division, the least value is nothing but the 1 mm. So, that means 1 main scale division is 1 mm. So, going to put the value multiplied by 1 mm. You can also get convert this into centimeter. If we want the answer to be find out in the terms of millimeter, so we will be having 1 by n. If we want to find out the answer in the range of centimeter, so you can write this as 0.1 centimeter by n, or further we can write it as 1 upon 10 n centimeter as our least count. Alright. This is the way how can we find out the least count of the vernier caliper. That is why I have given one complete lecture based on the vernier caliper, how to deal with that, all the kinds of error in the vernier calipers and all the kinds of error in the screw gauge. So, go through that lectures and understand that these kind of question can be arised from that topic. So, let us just move towards the next question. Okay, this is the question in which we have to simply evaluate the figures that has been given, and the question is related to the significant figures. The importance of the question over here is that you would be saying that it is very easier to calculate the addition part, but what is the main thing over here which you can be attempting in the wrong way is that here in this question it is a figure, it is that figure in which only one figure is present after the decimal. But if I focus on these two, after the decimal two digits are present, here four digits are present. So basically we will make the digits in the form like this, which is having the lower number of digits after the decimal that we are going to consider as our base. We are going to convert these two figures also in this form, where there will be only one digit after the decimal. So, now convert this 33.58. How we are going to convert this? As I have told you how to round off a figure, there were certain rules and I have took one class in making you understand. This is 33.58. Now, it is the figure which is more than 5. I told you that whenever the figure which we have to round off, we have to round off up to digit 5 because we want only one digit after the decimal. So, this is the place which we have to take care of. This is more than 5, and the moment you see that this digit is more than 5, you are going to add plus 1 in this digit so that it will be left with, let me just write over here. You are going to add plus 1 over here and the result will be like this, 33.6. Because this is more than 5, 8, so that is why we are going to add plus 1 over here. Now, moving on to the second number, that is 0.0631. We have to get the value up to this because we want only one digit after the decimal. So, how we are going to do? We are going to check whether the digits after the 0 is more than 5 or less than 5 or even 5 as well. So, here I can see I can drop this 1 as well. I can drop this 3 as well. Now I have to check the digit which is nearer to the 0, and the digit which is very much near to the 0 is 6, that is more than 5. And if it is more than 5, then again you are going to add 1 over here. So when you will be adding 1 over here, you will be having 0.1. Okay. Now the third case, we are going to take this figure as such, because we are considering this as our base. So now you can add them up: 33.6, 0.1 and 416.5. Let me just write over here. Now add them up: 6, 6, 12. We are having this as our answer. Okay. Yeah. So this is the way, because we wanted our answer to be found out in the least number of digits after the decimal. So we have found out in such a manner. Okay. This was the base of the question and nothing else, to make you understand how we are going to solve such questions. Okay, now we are having a question which is related to the resistances. If two resistances are R1 5 plus minus 0.2 watt and R2 equals to, this should not be watt, this should be ohm, because this is the unit of resistance, and R2 is 10 plus minus 0.1 ohm. Now find out the equivalent resistance in first of all series, and then in parallel with the limits of possible percentage error in each case. Now, first of all, let us just calculate the equivalent resistance in series. We know that in series combination, the equivalent resistance can be written as R1 plus R2. So, we will be simply writing that in series RS equals to R1 plus R2. Now R1 is given as 5 plus minus 0.2 ohm, plus R2. R2 has been given as 10 plus minus 0.1 ohm. Now simply we can say 5 will be added with 10. So we are having 15 plus minus, this error will be simply added with this number. So 0.2 plus 0.1, that is 0.3. This is the error or the resistance in the series combination. Now let me just move towards the parallel combination. I know that the combination of parallel resistors is having one formula to find out the equivalent resistance, that is Rp equals to R1 R2 upon R1 plus R2. Now I can write it as R1 R2 upon R1 plus R2. R1 plus R2 is what? Rs. So I can put this Rs over here. Now because I want to find out the error, I can find it as delta Rp upon Rp into 100% equals to delta R1 upon R1 plus delta R2 upon R2 plus delta Rs upon Rs. We are going to apply the formula of finding the error in this equation, R1 multiply R2 divided by Rs. And simply we have written this in this manner. This you would have learnt in the chapter errors. Now delta R1, which is the delta R1? This was the case of R1, this is delta R1. This is the value of R2, here this is delta R2. Now going to put the value over here, delta R1 is 0.2 divided by R1. R1 is 5 plus delta R2, delta R2 is 0.1. So 0.1 divided by 10 plus delta Rs. Now here is the value of Rs. Delta Rs is 0.3 and the value of Rs is 15. So 0.3 divided by 15. Now simply we can do one thing. Delta Rp upon Rp equals to 0.2 by 5. So we are going to take the LCM, we will be having 1.2 plus 10, 3s are 30, so 0.3 plus 15, 2s are 30, so 0.6, 0.9, so we will be having 2.1 divided by 30. This is the error in the parallel combination. Now one more thing, is that earlier we have to check what was the combination of the parallel resistors. This is the error in the parallel resistors. But if we want to find out the original, that was R1 R2 upon R1 plus R2. That is 5 multiplied by R2. R2, what is the value of R2? That is 10 divided by 5 plus 10. That is 15. So 10 divided by 3, you will be having 3.3 something as your value of Rp, that means parallel combination. So we can say that delta Rp will be equals to, or you can say the percentage error in this will be equals to plus minus this error, the error that I have got over here. You have to check what is the answer of this 2.1 divided by 30, because I am not going to do the division over here. You are going to put this 2.1 divided by 30 over here. That will be your error multiplied by 100. Okay? Or simply you can multiply this term by 100. That is how you can put the value over here, so that you can get your answer of a percentage error in the parallel combination. So this is how we can attempt this question. Now we should move towards the next question. The next question is question number 6, which says that if x equals to a raised to the power 1 by 2, b raised to the power 2 by 3 divided by c square, and error in measurements of a, b, c are 2%, 6% and 4% respectively. So find out the percentage error in the measurement of x. So let us just apply the one formula that we know about the error, which is that delta x upon x equals to, first of all, we are going to write the equation. Let me just write the equation firstly. X equals to a raised to the power 1 by 2, b raised to the power 2 by 3 and c square. This is the equation. Now apply the formula delta x by x equals to 1 by 2 multiplied delta a by a, because you know that this power will be coming into front, and they will be simply added up. Here 2 by 3 will be coming over here, 2 by 3 delta b upon b plus c square. So 2 will be added, 2 will be coming in front, 2 multiplied delta c by c. This is the way to find out the error. So put all the values. Delta a by a, it has been given as 2%. In the question, we are having delta a by a into 100%. Let me just make it correct. Multiplied by 100% equals to 2%. Similarly, delta b by b multiplied by 100% equals to 6%. And similarly for c by c into 100% equals to 4%. Now, because here we are going to find out the percentage error, so you can simply multiply it by 100, 100 and 100. 100 multiplied by 100% multiplied by 100%, and similarly this is nothing but multiplied by 100%. So we will be simply having 1 by 2 multiplied by 2% plus 2 by 3 multiplied by 6% plus 2 multiplied by 4%. So this is 1% plus 4% plus 8%. That means 8 plus 1, 9, 9 plus 4, 13. So total error in the X is 13%, and which is your answer. So percentage error in the measurement of X is 13%. This is the answer. Now, without wasting the further time, we should move towards the next question. The question number 7. Here in this question, the time dependence of physical quantity P is given by the equation P equals to P naught exponential of alpha t square. Let me just write the equation P equals to P naught. E, we can write the exponent as E raised to the power alpha t square, where alpha is a constant and t is the time. So what should be the dimension of alpha? What we have to do? We have to find out the dimension of alpha. Now firstly, let me just introduce you over the one important thing. When we talk about the power of exponent, the power of exponent has zero dimension. They are dimensionless. We say that they are dimensionless. So that means alpha t square is dimensionless. What I said, mark my words, the power of exponent is dimensionless. So alpha t square is dimensionless. So we can write this alpha t square as m0, l0 and t0. Okay. Now because alpha is constant and we have to find out the value of t, so we can write this as alpha equals to 1 upon t square. Is it alpha t square? Yeah, 1 upon t square. So the value of alpha, the dimension of alpha from here is nothing but 1 upon the dimension of t. So that means the dimension of alpha is t minus 2. This is what is the dimension of alpha. So now this was the question. This was a good question, I should say, because the important thing over the question is that we can correlate this relation alpha equals to 1 by t square only and only when we are saying this is dimensionless. Okay. Now, shall we move to the next question? The question number 8. In this question, we have been said that if unit of power is 10 by 6 urge per minute, unit of force is 10 raised to the power 3 dyne, and unit of time is 10 raised to the power minus 1 second. So find out the unit of length. We can correlate this relation as the length is proportional to, first of all, we have been given the power. Power raised to the power a, let us just say. Then we have been given unit of force, so force raised to the power b, and then we have been given the time, so time raised to the power c. We have been given this. So first of all, we should write out the dimension of all these things. Length is having dimension of capital L, it should be written as such. Power, now find out the dimension of power. Power equals to work upon time, and work is force into displacement, ML2 t minus 2 into divided by t. So that means ML2 t minus 3 is the dimension of power. So put the value of, let me just equate this equation, ML2 t टी माइनस थ्री रेज टू द पावर ए. नाउ फोर्स, फोर्स इज सिंपली मास इन मास इनटू एक्सेलरेशन, एम एल टी माइनस टू रेज टू द पावर बी. नाउ टी दैट मीन्स टाइम, टाइम इज सिंपली सी. फ्रॉम हियर वी कैन कोरिलेट दिस एज, बिकॉज देर इज ओनली लेंथ सो वी कैन राइट इट एज एम जीरो एल वन टी जीरो. नाउ इक्वेट दिस इक्वेशन, एम इज हैविंग पावर ऑफ ए प्लस बी, ए प्लस बी इक्वल्स टू जीरो. वी आर कोरिलेटिंग विद द लेफ्ट हैंड साइड एंड राइट हैंड साइड. ए प्लस बी इक्वल्स टू जीरो, दिस द पावर ऑफ एम. नाउ कंसीडर फॉर द पावर ऑफ एल, इट इज टू ए प्लस बी इक्वल्स टू वन. फ्रॉम हियर वी कैन से ए इक्वल्स टू माइनस बी. द थर्ड इक्वेशन इज टाइम, माइनस थ्री ए माइनस टू बी प्लस सी इक्वल्स टू जीरो. सो वॉट वी कैन से, माइनस थ्री ए माइनस टू बी प्लस सी इक्वल्स टू जीरो. Now we know that a equals to minus b, so put this value a equals to minus b, we'll be having 3b minus 2b plus c equals to 0. So that means b plus c equals to 0, or we can further say b equals to minus c. Now we are having two equation, a equals to minus b, b equals to minus c. Put this equation into this, 2a plus b equals to 1. We know that a equals to minus b, so we can write it as 2a, a equals to minus b, minus 2b plus b equals to 1, or we can say minus b equals to 1. So b equals to minus 1. Now since b equals to minus 1, a equals to minus b, so that means a equals to 1. Now thirdly, b equals to minus c, so that means b should be equals to 1. Sorry, I was talking about c. Since b is minus 1 and b equals to minus c, so c equals to plus 1. So we are now having the value of a, b and c. We can relate with them, and I have to check what we have to find in the question. We have to find the unit of length. So what we are now going to do, we are going to put the value that has been given. L has been given as power. Power is 10 raised to the power 6 urge per minute. I am going to convert this minutes into seconds. 1 minute equals to 60 seconds. You will understand why I am doing so, because we want to have the basic unit, the fundamental units. Unit of force is 10 raised to the power 3. Dyne. This is having a power, is having value of a. So what is a? A is 1. So put 1 over here. 10 raised to the power 3, that means force, which is having b. So this is minus 1. And the third one, that is the unit of length. Sorry, the unit of time. Unit of time is 10 raised to the power minus 1 second. And the second is having the power of c, so c is 1. So we are now going to find out the unit of length from here. 10 raised to the power, this was second, so second and second will be cancelled, because this has been given in dyne and this has been given in urge, so the answer will be coming into centimeter, because length we are finding out. So 10 raised to the power 6 multiplied 10 raised to the power minus 3 multiplied by 10 raised to the power minus 1 divided by 60. When you are going to solve this, you are going to have your answer something like, maybe it is 5 by 7 or 5 by 3, something like this would be coming when you are going to solve for this approximate. So this is the way how you are going to find out the firstly dimension. And let me just tell you, this was the question which has came out from the application of dimensions analysis. So that you have to understand, this was the important part to learn about the applications of the dimensions. Moving to the next question, I can see that the frequency of vibration f of a mass m suspended from a spring of spring constant k is given by a relation of the type f equals to c m raised to the power x k raised to the power y, where c is a dimensionless constant. We have to deduce the value of x and y. So let us just start with that. This is frequency and the relation is c m raised to the power x k raised to the power y. In the question, what we have to find out? We have to find out the value of x and y. So how can we find out the value of x and y? Simply, we know that the c is constant, m is mass and k is spring constant. We are going to put the value of all the dimension of all these terms, frequency. Frequency is reciprocal of time. So what should be the dimension of frequency? It is t minus 1. M is simply mass. So m is having the dimension as capital M. K. Now k is spring constant. So we have to find out the dimension by the formula f equals to kx. So here from f equals to kx, the value of k is f upon x. So the dimension of k will be force upon x, that means mlt, minus 2 divided by x, that is l. So simply it is having dimension of mt minus 2. So putting all these values into this equation, we will be having f, that means t minus 1. Equals to c constant, we can ignore also, m ky, m is raised to the power x and k raised to the power y. K is nothing but mt minus 2, this is y. So simply we can find out from here, t is m is x minus x plus y is 0. So this is x, this is y, and here the value, I can write this as m0 l minus 1, sorry, l0 t minus 1. So from here we can say x plus y equals to 0. And another thing that we are having, t raised to the power minus 2y, minus 2y equals to minus 1. So from here we can say y equals to 1 by 2 and x equals to minus y. So we can say x equals to minus 1 by 2. This is the answer. And this is the way how to attempt this question. Now, this was the question. This was again a good question to understand. Now, the last question of the session. The question says that a quantity x equals to epsilon naught L multiplied by L delta V by delta T, where epsilon naught is permittivity of free space, L is the length, delta V is potential difference and delta T is time interval. So we have to find the dimensional formula for x, and again they are asking it is same as that of current or resistance. So we have to find out for the, first of all we will be finding out, then we will be verifying whether this is the formula of current or the resistance. So let us just begin. X equals to epsilon naught L multiplied by delta V by delta T. Now first of all, to find out the dimension of epsilon naught, we are having the formula force equals to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 by R square. From here we will be having the value. Now can we easily find out the dimension of epsilon naught? This is the constant value, ignore this. We are having q1 q2 divided by fr square. So the value of epsilon naught will be equals to, the dimension of epsilon naught will be equals to q1 q2. Charge is what? Current into time. So we can simply write it as A, that means for current, time. Again Q2, that means A into T, divided by force, that means MLT minus 2, multiplied by R square, that means L raised to the power 2. So we are having with us the dimension of epsilon naught as A2 T2 multiplied by M minus 1 L minus 3, because this is 2 plus 1 3, so when it will go upwards that will be minus 3, and this is T minus 2. Or we can simply write it here as well, A2 T2 divided by M L3 T minus 2. Now, because T is already present over there, A2 M minus 1 L minus 3 T minus T4. This is the dimension for epsilon naught. Now again we have to find out the dimension for delta V as well. So we know that I can find out the delta V, the dimension for delta V, by using the formula, that is potential equals to work upon charge. So using that formula, I will be having, note down this is the important, delta V, W upon Q. So work is equals to force into displacement. Force is MLT minus 2 into L. So ML2 T minus 2 can be easily written, divided by charge. Now charge is again A into T. So when you are putting A into T over here, you can simply write it as M2 ML2 T minus 2 plus 1 multiply A minus 1. So that means you will be having ML2 T minus 1 A minus 1. Now by putting these two equations, these two formulas in this particular equation, we can easily find out the value, the dimension formula for x. So we are now going to put the value. The x equals to epsilon naught. The dimension of epsilon naught is A2 M minus 1 L minus 3 T4 multiplied by L. The dimension for L is simply L. Now delta V by delta T. Since delta V is, delta V is ML2 T minus 1 A minus 1 divided by delta T, or you can write this T as minus 1, sorry, simply as capital T. Now by solving this, we can easily find out the value of x. A M minus 1 plus 1, they will be cancelled. So cancelled. L minus 3, and here L minus 3 plus 1, that is minus 2 plus 2. So these lengths are cancelled. T4, and over here we are having T minus 1 plus 1. So that will be cancelled. Now we are left with, I can see that we would have done something wrong over here, because this is T minus 1 and this is T. I can write it as delta T. So T minus 1 again, T minus 2. So 4 minus 2 is nothing but minus 2. But yeah, because I know that I have attempted some mistake, because at that time these will be cancelled with each other. We will be only left with A raised to the power 2 minus 1. That means A. This is the dimension of A. And for that we can simply say this is nothing but the dimension of current, because current is ampere and the dimension of current is A. And over here the dimension of x is also A. So it is matched with A. So now these were the questions that can be asked from this chapter. You can check over here which is the mistake we would have attempted while finding out the dimension formula for epsilon naught or delta V. You can check that out. Okay, so you could have noted all these questions. You can have a practice of these questions. We will be meeting again with the next topic, with the next chapter. Till then, just keep practicing. Thank you.